Why even define a BIM contract?
It's a really good question. Why should we? Why define
it? Is it really important?
Must be.
So is this the right BIM? Is this the BIM that you asked for?
Looks like BIM to me.
It's a pretty good BIM.
Yeah.
What do you think? It's like there's walls in there and ceilings, and I think that's BIM, isn't it? BIM?
Yeah.
What about this?
Looks is that like more BIM?
That looks like more BIM.
Yeah, just a little bit more.
But is that the BIM you needed?
Maybe.
Maybe?
Yeah, maybe.
And how about this?
Definitely.
Definitely?
Definitely the BIM I wanted. So, yeah, three types.
They're different models. There's different amounts of elements. I'm sure there's different amounts of accuracy, mm-hmm. different amounts of detail, different amounts of development, different amounts of reliability, different amounts of data, different amounts of documentation, etc. So, we face this problem all the time. We have a set of stakeholders on a project, and they each have their own opinion of what BIM should be at certain points in time.
Right. Every one of those people might have a different goal.
Absolutely.
You know, and so they will want to produce something that is more valued for them or their company.
And so Derek, poor Derek, he didn't get what he was looking for. He didn't get what he required.
Right. Sometimes we have owners with this exact same face. Like, what is this? I didn't pay for this.
This isn't what I expected.
Yeah.
A school for ants. Sorry if you don't get the reference. So how do we know what the model that we are either creating or receiving is going to be useful? Well, there are many uses, many model uses ranging from design through simulation, etc. Let's look at a few examples, five examples.
Yeah, so the first example is design reviews. We're seeing a lot more of AR and VR being introduced into the workflow. So now more than ever, now more than ever, we're being asked to model for this. So as an architect, we now have to know exactly what we're going to do for these design reviews and to make sure we're aligned with the owner.
Yep. And then for quantities and cost estimation. So knowing what we're going to take off from the model, making sure that the concrete is complete and making sure that we are very certain about the elements needed before we go and try and take off quantities is really important, because missing quantities is going to be a problem for the cost.
Yeah, one of the most common BIM uses is coordination. So whether you're in design or in construction, we're seeing a lot more coordination in the projects, and it's very, very convenient for constructability issues or just finding major issues on site before they get on site. So, or in the model before they get on site. So this is one of the most common BIM uses.
And then phase planning, understanding sequencing and 4D simulations, being able to see it virtually construct over time. Mm-hmm. Well, what is it that we're going to see virtually construct? Let's make sure that we've got the things that we do want to sequence and make sure that we've got the phases that we want to understand.
A lot more safety.
And safety,
for that.
And then as-built and handover models, if we'd like to see all of that data and visualize this internet of things, we need to have the item or the data coming from somewhere. So we need to plan out what we need, whether that's information requirements from some of these items in the model. So there are so many reasons why we would need to understand exactly who is responsible for what and when, and tie that to one of those uses.